So basically what we're going to be doing this afternoon is we're going to be looking at the fossil record. And fossils have often piqued the interest of those people young and old. So these are the questions we'll be looking to answer. What are all these bones and stones? How did they get there in the first place? Is Darwinian evolution a flawed theory if we look at the fossil record, or is it a sound theory? What were the dinosaurs really like? Why did or could dinosaurs and people possibly have existed at the same time? How did they die? Did dinosaurs really evolve into birds? We'll have a look at the evidence there. And why do the creatures seem so different to what we have today? Now then, what we tend to see in the textbooks is something like this. This is called the geologic column. And we can see here that this reflects an evolution from simplicity to complexity. And down here we have the Cambrian layer, which is meant to be 600 million years ago. And prior to that, possibly some bacteria, algae, that kind of thing beginning to form. And we have the eukaryotes, which is what we call the single cellular organisms, from the ones that don't have a nucleus to the ones that do have a nucleus. And then we had the sudden explosion then of marine animals in the Cambrian period, and then things are beginning to go from simple to complex. But in actual fact, we don't have simple organisms. Let us get this straight right from the beginning. There's no such thing as a simple organism. Every organism on this planet is highly, highly, highly complex. They have all kinds of structures. Everything that they need is in place right from the very beginning. So that's the first point to note. Then we go up through the Ordovician, the Silurian, where we started to get the first land animals. And then we've got the Devonian, which is known as the Age of the Fish. Some very, very interesting fish fossils there. We'll have a look at some of those in a minute. And the whole record there is just absolutely covered in fish. Then we go up through the Mississippian, the Pennsylvanian, and we have plants, we have ferns, cycads, non-flowering plants. So it's assumed that the non-flowering plants came first and the flowering plants came later. And then we have the Permian, where we have the first reptiles. And then we move from this whole Paleozoic period to the Mesozoic. And then we have the reptiles coming into the dinosaurs. So we have the Triassic, the Jurassic, and the Cretaceous. Then suddenly there's this blanket destruction of everything, known as the KT layer. And finally then we have the Cenozoic, where we have first mammals, and eventually we get to the dawn of man. And this is how it's depicted from simple to complex in the textbooks. Right now, question. Where in the world can we actually find this geologic column? The answer to that question is nowhere. Nowhere in the world, anywhere, do we find the geologic column as it's presented in the textbooks. It's something that's been pieced together. So you have some layers on some continent, and some other layers on another continent, and they put them all together as if they evolved. Even at the Grand Canyon, we have less than half of the geologic column. And all the layers there are all mixed up. They're all in the wrong order, not how you'd expect them to be. So when you see this in the textbooks, as it's depicted here, that's not what we actually find out there. And that is a key point. Okay, besides that as well, there's more than one way of getting a record. Imagine I had a garden pond, and right at the bottom of the pond, we have very small creatures. Simple organisms crawling about, bacteria, little worms, creepy crawlies, that kind of thing. Then we go a little bit higher, we might have fish there, a little bit higher up, we might have a frog, sort of half in the water, half out, and a duck right on top of the pond, and then maybe some birds around, and it looks like a turtle there. Imagine a huge catastrophe came along and buried my pond from the side, and then a little while later I dug the pond up. I would find everything buried in that sequence. So would I then conclude that the creepy crawlies at the bottom evolved into the fish, who evolved into the frog, who evolved into the ducks, who evolved into the birds, who evolved into the turtle? Not necessarily, right? So there's other ways of explaining how we can get this kind of sequence going on. Right, mammals and birds also, they tend to float. So basically, that's why a lot of those would be higher up in the fossil record, because they were floating at the time before they were buried. So that's another point. And also, creatures like crinoids, they live deep, deep, deep in the ocean. So naturally, they'd be found deep, deep, deep in the fossil record. Right, now this is the principle of fossil correlation. So how do they decide how old these creatures are? Well, if I have a fossil in a layer, there it is, and I find the same fossil in another layer there, or this one here, for example, and I find the same fossil in another layer there, I assume that these two layers, even though they look different, are of the same age. So the fossil gets its age from the layer, and the layer gets its age from the fossil. That's what we call circular reasoning. But there's no date on them, so how do they decide what date to put on them? Well, because evolution takes millions and millions of years, they can basically put whatever dates they want onto them. Whatever you like, no problem at all. Okay. In the book Evolution of Life by Olson, we read, time and again, wind, water, and ice have cut and destroyed rocks that have been elevated to form continents. That there is a fossil record at all seems rather remarkable, and this is a key point. In the layers, in the rocks, you've got all these fossils, all right? And imagine a mountain, it's been eroded away over centuries. So mountains have been eroded away. The Himalayas, for example, erode about 2 meters every 1,000 years. So if that's happening, and this has been happening for millions of years, why is the mountain still there? Well, science comes up with the answer, and it says the mountain is still there because of uplift. We call that orogeny. And basically, the mountain has been uplifted from the bottom and it's been eroded away from the top. But now, there's a massive problem, because if this has been going on for millions of years, and science says it's been going on for 126 million years, eroding and rubbing out at the top, being lifted up from the bottom, the fossils are in between. What's happening to that fossil record? It's being eradicated. So if that had been going on for that length of time, there would be no fossil record left. Major, major problem. Besides which, scientists have also worked out that if that had been happening at that kind of rate for 126 million years, then all the continents would have been gone about 12 times over into the sea. There would be no continents left. So that's a huge problem as well. So some scientists have this tongue-in-cheek statement: historical geology is a record of events, most of which never took place in time, and much of which never existed. Okay. Right, now, what conditions actually favour fossilisation? So what creates fossils? Well, in this book, Historical Geology, we read this: if covered by moist sediment, weathering is prevented. For these reasons, quick burial is perhaps the most important condition favouring fossilisation. So everything had to be buried quickly to fossilise. Waterborne sediment is so widely distributed than other ages of burial that they include the great majority of fossils. So everything had to be buried quickly, because otherwise it would rot away and the predators come and then disintegrate and everything's gone. And everything was buried in water. So I wonder if that's starting to ring any bells. So quick burial in water creates fossils. And we have fossils all over the world. Isn't that interesting? Things have to be buried quickly in order not to rot away and disappear. So everything appears to be buried in water, everything has to be buried rapidly. What buries a whale or a dinosaur rapidly if it's not a major, major catastrophe? All is buried in water sediments, but according to science, there was no water catastrophe, there was no flood. Does that make any sense? Okay, now science will tell us that one of the reasons we don't have a complete fossil record is because soft-bodied organisms don't fossilise readily. They tell us it's only the hard parts of a fossil, like the bones, that will fossilise. That's not true. There's a trilobite, for example. There's one. Completely fossilised, soft-bodied creature. There's a jellyfish, fossilised. And we have some fossilisation of creatures from the Ordovician period there as well. And with regards to those, the article I researched said the conditions at this Moroccan site, Professor Biggs from Yale University explained, so great professor, were special. Very thick mud, marine muds, he said, were laid down in the deep ocean, trapping the creatures' bodies below the influence of storms. Okay, interesting. Right, and the Institution of Creation Search says this: soft-bodied creatures can only be fossilised in fast-moving water processes, like this squid fossil. So another soft-bodied creature, fossilized readily, and it can only happen in water, it can only happen quickly if it's buried rapidly. What buries these things rapidly other than some major catastrophe like a flood? Right, so there it is again, quick burial, famous fossilization. Look at this fish here, absolutely perfect. You can even see the little ripple marks around it as well. So this fish was literally buried alive. The oxygen supply was cut off instantly. Look at this one as well. It's actually buried here while it was eating another fish. So it was swimming around, saw another fish, took a bite, but before it could say, who goes there, splat, it was buried. One other interesting thing about fish is that some of them in the fossil record are losing their heads or have lost their heads. Now, when a fish is dead and is rotting, the first thing that happens is that the ligament holding the head on rots away and the head falls off. And then starts to implode, the scales puff up, they basically start to disintegrate, the scavengers come. Before you know where you are, that thing is absolutely gone. So those that don't have the heads, that just means they floated in the water for a short time and then they were buried. But basically, what we see is many, many fossils buried instantly. Right, now this fish here, this is the sturgeon. And I actually did some work with sturgeon a few years ago because I was assistant manager in the aquatics department. We had these sturgeon come in and they would be about this size when they were babies. But these fish just grow and grow and grow, they don't stop. So when people decided to buy them, we used to say, oh, how big's your tank? And if they said, oh, it's about this big. And they say, right, we had a more of a full-grown one in a pond at the end, which was 6 foot long. We say, right, it's going to grow into this. So unless you can accommodate that, don't bother buying them. That was the main message. And these have kind of bony, heavy bony scales on them. And you can see them fossilized there. And there's not much difference between the fossilized one and the modern one there. We'll have a look at some examples later. But it's quite an advanced feature. But when science looks at these fish, they say, oh, this fish must be very old. It must have an ancient, ancient origin. And they do exactly the same with a rhino. A rhino looks kind of twisted and folded, doesn't it? So what do they say about the rhino? Well, this must have an ancient origin as well. It must go all the way back. But in actual fact, a rhino is a mammal. Hello, when did the mammals come along? Recent times, even according to evolutionary theory. So we can't let our mindset dictate data. This is a modern fish, it's living now, and has heavy bony scales, which are an advanced feature, but if we look at the fossilized version, there's no change. So where's the evolution there? Right, now, if we go to any of the textbooks, we see things like this. We see dinosaurs walking around, and then there's some volcanic eruption. And then we're told that the volcanic eruption, the lava probably buried the dinosaurs. Dinosaurs are buried. Then over millions and millions and millions of years, you have these nutrients seeping into the bones. The bones get turned into solid stone. And then erosion comes along that we've been talking about already. It uncovers them, and then we can find them, and then we can study them. But if we actually look at the fossil record, that's not what we see at all. What we see is bones of dinosaurs washed into great washes. Most of them are disarticulated, which means that they've been tossed around and torn from limb from limb. We never usually find a whole dinosaur. The most that's ever been found, in fact, was 80% of a dinosaur. It doesn't happen. So that's what we tend to see. It's not as it's depicted in the textbooks. And if you look at the colour here of the rocks themselves, it's quite light, almost chalky, which means that it could only really have happened underwater. All right, moving on. How long does it take for these things to form? They say millions of years. Well, here we have a miner's hat, and we saw lots of examples last time, but we have a miner's hat here. And this is from a mine that was vacated about 50 years ago. And as we can see, it is solid stone. And then these teddy bears in the petrifying well in Yorkshire, they're put there, and within 6 months to a year, they are turned into solid stone because the water's high in the nutrients needed for such a purpose. The Bible says that a lot of the water came from underneath the earth as well when the flood happened, so that water would have been full of the right kinds of minerals needed for the purpose as well. Okay, now, let's have a look at Darwinism. The Darwinism has a logic about it. It's logical. So you can certainly say that for it. But it requires gradualism, which means that you expect to see in the fossil record gradual change from one organism to another. So you should be able to pick up incremental changes within the fossil record as these animals develop. But do we actually see this in the fossil record? No, is the answer. We do not see that. What we find is the animals are there, instantly formed, fully formed, and there's no changes in between them. And this is a huge problem. So some scientists are still holding on to that Darwinian theory, and that's basically the science you find taught to our children in schools every single day. Other scientists have come along and tried to make sense of this lack of transition in the fossil record. So they came up with something called punctuated equilibrium. And that means evolving at supersonic speed. And the Time magazine picked up on this and splashed it all over the place so that people get familiar with it. Evolution's Big Bang. New discoveries show that life as we know it began in an amazing biological frenzy that changed the planet almost overnight. Interesting wording. And neo-Darwinists like Stephen Jay Gould and others that worked at Harvard were the ones that championed this kind of theory. Jeffrey Levinson now, professor of ecology and evolution at Stony Brook University. So he's someone pretty qualified to talk about this subject. And this was published in Scientific American, considered one of the best journals in the world, in an article called The Big Bang of Animal Evolution. And he writes, the Cambrian explosion. Now that's that lowest layer we talked about earlier. The Cambrian explosion was characterized by the sudden and roughly simultaneous appearance of many diverse animal forms almost 600 million years ago. No other period in this history of animal evolution can match this, note the wording, remarkable burst of evolutionary creativity. Evidence from the various species suggests that many phyla, and what's a phyla? Okay, a phyla is a huge category of animals. So all the slugs, all the snails, all the sea mollusks, and the squids, and the octopus constitute one phyla. So these are massive categories of animal we're talking about here. And he's saying that many phyla appeared almost simultaneously, perhaps during the latter part of the pre-Cambrian period. So he's saying practically everything was there right from the beginning. Interesting. Okay, and the Institute of Creation Research confirms this. The Cambrian layer shows an explosion of nearly all major animal groups, not gradual evolutionary change. Stephen Jay Gould, now he published this in the journal Nature, great journal, considered again one of the best in the world, in an article called Of It, Not Above It. And he says, fast turns out to be much faster than anyone ever thought. Older textbooks claim that our phylum, the Chordata, so that's the phylum that we as humans belong to, did not appear until the subsequent Ordovician period. And this later evolution must imply advanced status. So we're considered the best thing since sliced bread on Earth, aren't we? We're considered the most advanced of everything else. So we must have come last, is what science tells us. We must have come last. But the Burgess Shale formation contains a chordate. Now let me explain that. The Burgess Shale formation is a fossil field in the Canadian Rockies and the British Columbia of Canada. It's 508 million years old, middle of the Cambrian period, and they found a chordate there, which means we were there then. Shen and his colleagues, continues Gould, their discovery of beautifully preserved and unambiguously identified chordate from the still earlier Shenyang fauna now seals the fate of this misguided attempt to assign specialness for our ancestry. Chordates arose in the Cambrian explosion. Oops. What does that mean? That means everything, every life form, kind, type, was there from when? From the beginning. Gould continues, during the past decade, the discovery and development of another fauna of marvellously preserved soft-bodied Cambrian organism in China has proven that, note, full diversity was reached in the Cambrian explosion itself. So everything was there right from the start. Now, is this something new? Here writes Charles Darwin in the first edition of Origin of Species. Strange that it disappears from subsequent editions, by the way. When referring to the fossil record, he says, the case at present must remain inexplicable we're all the transitions, is what he's saying, and may truly be urged as a valid argument against the views here entertained. So he's being honest and saying we don't have this transition. So, you know, and that could be an argument against the ideas they're presented here. So they've known this right from the start. So, question now, is there a record showing things developing from simple to complex as we are taught and as our children are taught in schools every day? The answer is no. What we have is fully complex organisms there at the same time. Okay. Now then, if you look at the textbooks, this is the type of thing you tend to see. So basically you've got, right down here, your early reptiles, and then you have some other organisms here, and the dinosaurs, and here are all the modern ones across the top here. So these are what we actually see in the world today. Now, when a turtle appears in the fossil record, it's a turtle, complete. There's nothing leading up to it, there's nothing leading away from it. Snakes are snakes, crocodiles are crocodiles, all the way down. And all these linkages here, notice these dotted lines, and this piece down here are what? What we call inference. In other words, it's come from the mind. So we don't have evolutionary trees at all. What we have is these evolutionary lawns. So jung, 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 jung. Everything's there at the same time. It's not actually a tree. And basically, you're giving a pile of fossils to a scientist, and he then goes to the laboratory, puts them all together as if they evolved, but in actual fact, they're all mixed up in fossil record. They're all there at the same time. Very important that we realise that. So what it is a morphological sequence, not a paleontological sequence. Very important difference. So what processes do evolution require? So if evolution was true, we'd expect to see simple to complex. We'd expect development from small to large. Now that's logical as well, and that's called the law of Carroll. All right, small to large. Carroll was a scientist that said everything had to develop from small to large. There's no other way. Perfectly logical. So think about it. You don't start off with a rhinoceros and end up with an amoeba. You start off with the amoeba and end up with a rhinoceros. Perfectly logical. We'd also expect to see low diversity to high diversity. So if things suddenly exploded on the Earth or something started fortuitously and life started, you might even only have had one organism to start with, and eventually you could have more and more and more and more, if the theory is true, and then you go from low diversity to high diversity. But we don't seem to find that in the fossil record at all. What we have is instances of reducible, irreducible complexity. So some of the structures that we have in the fossil record are so complex that if you take any parts away from them at all, they wouldn't work. They have to be all there at the same time or be absolutely useless. And I'm going to show you some examples as we go on. So we have irreducible complexity. We have reverse size sequences. So if we go back to the fossil record, everything was bigger and larger and more magnificent than it is today. Again, we'll look at some examples later. And we have reverse diversity. So we go back into the fossil record again. We find far more animals and species and everything else in the past than we have now. So what we see in the fossil record is exactly the opposite of what we should see if Darwinian evolution is true. Right, so Stephen Jay Gould, in Natural History, 1977, here's a typical evolutionary tree. So this is what we call the one branch here. So everything comes up there, there's the trunk as it were, and we have these branching off. But notice there's no real data here, we only have the data at the end. So there's the fish, fully formed. We're told that comes from the vertebrates. There's no other fossils pictured down here. So he made a note of that. He obviously came up with punctuated equilibrium. And he said the evolutionary trees that adorn our textbooks have data only at the tips and nodes of their branches. The rest is inference. However reasonable, not the evidence of the fossils. So it might be logical, but it's not what we find. It's what, okay. Now then, whatever you do, don't confuse logic with correctness. Now imagine I gave you a pile of dog skulls, and it was every conceivable dog type in the world, and you've never seen dogs before, and I said to you, create for me an evolutionary tree. What you'd probably do is you'd probably start off with one of the small ones, like a chihuahua, something like that, put that down the bottom on the one branch, and then on the one side you'd probably have, coming from that, you'd have the pug and the boxers getting bigger as you go up. You'd have the in-between ones in the middle, and then right over the other side, you'd probably have the ones with the long snoots, like the whippets, the Afghans, that kind of thing. And it would all be perfectly logical, and you'd have this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful tree. Logical, yes, but would it be correct? No, it would be absolutely wrong. Why? Because they didn't come from the Chihuahua, they came from the wolf breeds, and the evolution is non-existent. What we have there is the variety that we see in the gene pool, from the smallest to the largest. It's got nothing to do with evolution at all. It does not reflect evolution in any way, shape, or form. Right, so let's move on to the dinosaurs now, and all these other interesting creatures. So, here's Time magazine, The Truth About Dinosaurs. Surprise, just about everything you believe is wrong. Okay, well that's nothing new. Okay, so here's a dinosaur tree now. And again, you can see something like the Triceratops, but there's nothing really leading up to it. You can see something like the Tyrannosaurus rex there. There's nothing leading up to that either. And then you've got birds right up on the top there, but there's nothing much transitioning between them. We're going to look at the birds a little bit later on. And are they buried in this sequence? So if we go to the fossil record, do we see them all buried in this sequence here? No, they're not buried in that sequence at all. They're all mixed up. So again, you're just giving a pile of bones to the scientist, and he sits in his laboratory and creates the tree. It's got nothing to do with what we actually find out there. Right, now, let's have a look at the Tyrannosaurus rex. This is my daughter's little toy. Now, if we look at this creature, we can see his anatomy, huge bouncing tail there, massive heavy legs there. He's got little tiny arms there, and then he's got these very sharp teeth. Now, what did Jurassic Park do with this creature? Everyone was running around in terror because this huge, vicious carnivore was going to destroy everything in its sight. And there's even one point where the Tyrannosaurus rex is running after the jeep, one of those jeeps there. And on the jeep's speedometer, you can see 45 miles an hour. But scientists have actually looked at this since then, and they've worked out that the T-Rex probably capable of maybe 10, 12 miles an hour at the most, because of its anatomy. That's the actual fact of the matter. And you also discover as well, if it fell down, because he's got these short arms, it would probably knock itself out cold if it fell down, because the arms wouldn't be enough to stop it from falling. So running at very, very hazardous speeds was not going to be on the agenda for it at all. And if the T-Rex wanted to catch something, how would it do it? Well, it would have to bend down and try and catch this creature, which was trying to run away at the same time, with its tiny little arms, and then bend down and try and pick it up with its mouth, while the creature is trying to run away. Now, there's a law in science that says what can be a carnivore and what cannot be a carnivore. To see something like an elephant would make a really bad carnivore. Why? Because it's too huge, it's too heavy, it's too bulky. Can you imagine an elephant trying to catch a gazelle? And the gazelle is going vum, 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 vum. And the elephant's going ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. And the gazelle goes vum. And the elephant goes for another 500 yards and tries to make a U-turn and come back. It would be hopeless as a carnivore. I can imagine an elephant possibly being a scavenger, maybe. But would it be able to get enough food to eat when you think even a fox gets as skinny as a rake through not being able to find enough food? Very, very unlikely. So creatures like these would be very, very bad carnivores because of their sheer body mass. But what about these teeth? What about these massive teeth that everybody says makes them definitely a carnivore? Well, first thing to note is that they're in very, very shallow sockets. So they'd be very good as crushers, as shredding machines, but for holding onto something and ripping it apart, those teeth would come out of those sockets in no time. So they're not going to be very effective. Very interesting study here, which I want to share with you as well, was something that claimed to prove that they were actually carnivores, but in actual fact, suggests more likely to be plant eaters. This is a 2015 study that I found on the T-Rex by Dr. Christine Brink of the University of Toronto. And she stated that the teeth were like knives. Dinosaur teeth have serrated edges designed to slice through meat. This is what she says, first of all. So, very good chance that they are carnivores, make them much more effective carnivores. But then, look what she says. In general, meat-eating animals have less complex teeth than plant-eaters, As plant eaters, plant matter has to be chewed and ground up. So it was surprising to find that theropods, which eat meat, had the same complexity as the plant eaters. So does that possibly suggest that they might have actually been plant eaters after all? Even some of the more modern articles coming out now are saying that T-Rexes may well have been scavengers, not these vicious carnivores that we're saying, because of this whole problem with the teeth and the fact that they're not going to be fast enough in order to get around and catch these creatures. So they're now saying they're scavengers. So they're kind of transitioning at the moment between the two. I think they were more likely to have been plant eaters, possibly scavengers as well. Okay. Right, now if you go to any of the museums, natural history ones, any one of them, this is how you'll see dinosaurs depicted. And there's all the blood and the gushing and the fighting, and they're depicted as highly vicious and they're ripping each other apart. The animal we have closest to a dinosaur today, in terms of that anatomy, is a kangaroo. And we don't tend to see them running around ripping everything apart, because their anatomy is just not suited to that. Well, I know they don't have the teeth, but the anatomy is just not suited to that kind of way of life. So what do? They eat plants. Now then, T-Rex blood. Now, we are told the dinosaurs died out 65 million years ago, all right? Now then, Mary Schweitzer of the Montana Museum of the Rockies in Science magazine in 1994, she was looking at T-Rex bones. And what did she say? It was like looking at a slice of modern bone, but of course I couldn't believe it. I said to the lab technician, the bones are, after all, 65 million years old. How could blood cells survive that long? You see, we found blood cells in the bones of a T-Rex that are meant to have been 65 million years ago. Well, I did some research on this. When she actually phoned her superior to tell him about this, his first reaction was to slam the phone down on her. And then eventually he began to accept what she was saying, and one of the things he said was, oh no, the creationists are going to love you. All right, so here's some other examples. So if we look at the first arrow, A, there it is. Look at what that's pointing to. The arrow points to a tissue fragment that is still elastic. It beggars belief that elastic tissue like this could have lasted for 65 million years. This one here, another instance of fresh appearance, which makes it hard to believe in the millions of years, and over here as well. Regions of bones showing where the fibrous structure is still present, compared to most fossil bones which lack this structure. But these bones claim to be 65 million years old, yet they managed to retain this structure. Okay, and then here we have science news from March 2005. Old softy, Tyrannosaurus fossil yields flexible tissue. And here we have photos of a hadrosaur, soft tissue including blood vessels, red blood cells, and collagen as well. So what were the evolutionists responding to this? How are they responding to it? Here's Cameron J. Chizita of the University of Western Ontario, and he says, the state of preservation noted in this new study is improbable, but obviously not impossible. Mm-hmm. Why is he saying this? Well, let's have a look at the work of Dr. G. Charles Jackson. He's a creation scientist. He's part of Mensa, by the way, which means he's in the genius club in the world, and he's got 4 degrees, and he's been a science teacher for years, and he also teaches teachers to teach science as well. And he says the reason that's Chizita, is saying this, is because every good organic chemist knows protein molecules cannot last, even in a perfectly freeze-dried state, because water causes the amino acid bonds, the peptide bonds, to cause protein to rot faster. Even in a perfectly dried state, they can last 10,000 years, 40,000 years tops. This hadrosaur had real cells, not petrified, with the real proteins left in them. It was a blood vessel like a dried up fishing worm. It was still elastic, the proteins were still intact. And this 80 million years is exactly 2,000 times longer than even the widest stretch of imagination, the 40,000 years that they're supposed to last. Real science says this cannot be. 2 years after this, on the PBS Nova website, they're still saying the alleged vein with the possible red blood cells in it. So they're still in denial, even 2 years after that. Okay, and there's Mary Schweitzer at the top there. And they also found a vein with red blood cells in a Mysore there, that's a good mother dinosaur, and in a Triceratops as well as the T-Rex. So we're not talking about one or two instances here, we're talking about quite a few, and there's more to come as well. The moa bird, we found red blood cells there, meant to be 10 million years old. In the mastodon, there it is, we found soft blood tissues, 300,000 years old, supposedly. These things cannot be if the chemical kinetics and the rate laws for the degradation of proteins, which has been repeatedly, experimentally demonstrated in labs, are true. Now, but what they've done now is they kind of turned Mary Schweitzer into a kind of a saint. Like saying, okay, she's discovered this great mystery and isn't it wonderful? It's like, you know, you're about to go to the prom at high school, you know, you get to the prom stage, and you think you've got this massive zit on your nose that's come out at night. So instead of trying to cover it up, you go to the prom and say, look, I've got this huge zit on the nose, I've been working on it for weeks, isn't that great? Look at that good one there. Right, it's basically, that's what they're doing. It's basically trying to spin doctor this thing. They're looking at their greatest flaw as if it's something fantastic, where in actual fact, it's one of the huge nails in the coffin of their theory. Right, also, what else have we found? Soft tissues in a 10 million year old frog. They found marrow in the bone. 400 year old bear DNA in a tooth. 90 million year old muscle tissue found in a Santana raptor, supposedly the ancestor of the T-Rex. Neanderthal DNA, and the Smithsonian magazine 2006 read, Schweitzer's work is just showing us that we really don't understand decay. There's a lot of basic stuff in nature that people just make assumptions about. Like, maybe evolution? So it's not like we got this evolution thing wrong, we've just got this decay thing wrong, is what they're trying to say. So, what do we trust? The known laws of science, or the assumptions that evolutionists keep making so that they can keep believing in Darwinism, against the data, against laboratory proven laws of science. That's what they're doing. Now, this is even worse. This is Christina O'Malley, and she's of the Ohio State University, and together with her superior, William Osich, I think you pronounce that, she basically found 300 million year old fossils of sea creatures known as crinoids. Now these are pigment molecules, like those in your eyes or those in your hair, and generally they contain proteins, and we already know that proteins cannot last more than 40,000 years. So, G. Charles Jackson, he decided to email Christina O'Malley and asked her if they'd discovered whether they're proteins or not. And she emailed back and said, oh no, we haven't decided whether they're proteins yet. So I don't know whether she got a sniff from his email that he's actually a creationist or not. But even if they're not, they are fragile, organic molecules lasting 350 million years. No chemical way. On we go. Right, on to the subject now of reptiles. So, did you know that reptiles continue to grow? They don't stop growing, they just get bigger and bigger and bigger. So when a tortoise is born, for example, it's probably about that big. And then, give them 100 years to grow, these on the Galapagos Islands, you get enormous reptiles like this. And some of these enormous reptiles here, that there you'd probably say was a dinosaur if you didn't know any different. So, in the past, if these animals allowed much time to grow, and conditions were much better, food was much more plentiful, the environment was much better, etc., it's understandable that these things could get really, 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 really big. And another problem that science is dealing with is how come whatever this catastrophe was that wiped out all the dinosaurs, how come it wiped out all the big ones but left the small ones? We've still got the small ones, okay? Big problem. Unless some of the small ones were on something called an ark. Right, now then, this is Dippy the dinosaur, and you might have seen this on the news in the last couple of weeks. Now this is the one that's going on a 2-year tour all around the country, excuse me, and basically the idea is next year and the year after, it's going to go to 8 different destinations in Britain, get people in touch with their local natural history, and one of the things on their agenda is to make children and young people aware of what their origins are. Origins in evolution. course. So they're pushing out this agenda again. Now, one of the reasons for this, this is my opinion, mind, nothing official, was the fact that not too long ago they did a study in America and only 37% of people said that they actually believed in Darwinian evolution. And more people said that they believed that the biblical flood of Noah shaped the modern earth than Darwinian evolution and intelligent design put together. So they had a bit of a flap over there. We must redouble our efforts. We've got to teach it. We're not teaching it enough. We're not getting out there. We're not indoctrinating enough. We need to get out there and teach it younger as well. Well, they're actually teaching it everywhere anyway. My daughter's come home from school with books saying that dinosaurs are 65 million years old. Peppa Pig says dinosaurs were 65 million years ago. It's taught all over the place. They've had 150 years and it's still not working for them. And it's falling apart. It's a myth. The Mythbuster is happening to it right now. You think about it. These dinosaurs cannot scientifically be that old, and yet they're still clinging on to it. Anyway, this is going around the country, so this is the latest effort in order to try and make it more popular and to try and get into people's minds. Notice the statue of Darwin right at the back there, who's been basically made into a god. The sauropod, this is the Diplodocus, of course, called Dippy, but the sauropod, it was huge, and it probably was a swamp creature living and feeding in swamps as well. And there have been sauropods sighted all over the world in modern days as well. I say all over the world, but in places like the Congo, where you can't get you know, the researchers in there, there's been all kinds of sightings all over the place. We'll look at that after the interval. Okay, now here we have, you know this one, the Triceratops. All right, there it is, with its three horns. And this was probably a plant eater. If you look at the beak, this shaped very similar to that of a tortoise. So they're probably right in saying that this indeed was a plant eater. The teeth there wouldn't be very good for eating meat, obviously. And then we've got these horns. What are the horns there for? Oh, well, this is what they'll tell us. The horns are there because it had to protect itself from what? From all these vicious dinosaurs all the way around. Okay, that's what it's there for. That's what science is teaching people. Well, here we have a chameleon. And this is a modern creature, obviously. You can get small ones, you can get larger ones as well. And it's a bit like a modern triceratops, but three horns there. And those horns are there to protect it from all the vicious creatures all around. True or false? Very false. What are those horns there for, do you think? Exactly. Those horns are there to look sexy. Exactly. When a female sees those horns, her knees just begin to wobble. And this is a really common thing all throughout nature. If we look at this, for example, the reindeer, it has these magnificent, magnificent horns. And during the mating season, it grows these horns, and then the males pick their horns together, and the females stand around and are very impressed. And the guy or the ranger that's got the biggest horns gets the ladies. That's the way it works. A bit like the youth of today, the ones with the best haircuts get the ladies. That's the way it happens. And then, after the mating season, what happens to those antlers? They fall off. Now, if they were really there to keep all the vicious carnivores away, that creature would be in big trouble for vast parts of the year, right? Okay, now, if we look at the museums and we see dinosaur eggs, the biggest dinosaur egg ever found was only about the size of a rugby ball, by the way, so it's, you know, these things tend to start quite small. In fact, some dinosaurs are only about the size of a chicken, so we need to bear that in mind as well. We see them in these kinds of environments. So they try and imagine what they would be like in a normal setting. But, of course, if you go to the fossil record, that's not what we find. We find them in these huge floodplains again, and they're washed together, sometimes orientated in the direction of the water as well. So that's what we actually find out there. So this, again, is conjecture. But it's not, okay? But it's not the evidence of the fossils. Right. Now, the death of the dinosaurs. Now, there are over 100 published theories of the death of the dinosaurs, and some of them are hilarious. Mass suicide is one. Cataract blindness is another one. That's a popular scientific theory as well. Caterpillars ate all the plants, so they had nothing to live on, which is interesting when they say a lot of them were carnivores anyway. And the other one is flatulation. Right, so they died of poisonous gases, and no prizes for guessing where the gases are meant to come from. So they range from the fascinating to the absurd. Do any of them actually explain the death of the dinosaurs? The most popular one is the asteroid theory. There are a number of issues with that, of course. They say that because they found certain elements on the surface of the Earth where they think the asteroid hit that they said initially could only have come from space. But then they found it's also in volcanic lava as well, so it could have come from volcanoes as well. So that's one of the problems. Another problem is that you see that kind of circumference that all the dinosaurs would have had to have been within that circumference for it to have killed everyone. And we find it all over the world. We find dinosaurs all over the world, so that's a bit of a problem. But what are the actual facts? All of them that we find are buried in huge floodplains, washed into position, even orientated in stream flow. Any eggs that we find are washed into position, but according to science, none of them died in the flood. And if we have a look at what this says here, though we find many whole skeletons, well, that's debatable. The biggest find is of radically disarticulated dinosaur bones. That means these dinosaurs were literally pulled apart limb from limb. Dinosaur bones and skeletons are packed one on top of the other as if they are sardines in a sardine tin. They were rapidly transported and then buried in massive flood and sand flows which happened to form part of the Morrison Formation. This formation stretches from New Mexico to Canada and covers significant portions of 10 US states. So we're talking a major, major catastrophe here, and it bears all the hallmarks of a flood. Again, you can see how light the colour of the stone is, suggesting chalk deposits, which could only have happened in water. Okay, now, dinosaur footprints. Here's some tracks near that Morrison Formation, or in that Morrison Formation in Colorado. And most of the footprints seem to be going uphill in mud. And sometimes the way the impressions are made, the dinosaurs are running uphill in mud. Why would dinosaurs be running uphill in mud? Rising floodwaters, perhaps? Okay, and this is an interesting one. I was out shopping with my family in a supermarket, Lidl's. Right, not that we are, well, yeah, right. Moving on, Lidl's, and there was a book there. That they tend to sell from time to time. You know, with Lidl's, you get the books in and then you go out and then something else comes in. But I noticed this very interesting article here. This is a dinosaur called the Coelophysis, or something like that, I think it's pronounced. And it says their death at Ghost Ranch. In 1947, over 1,000 fossils of Coelophysis were found at a place called Ghost Ranch in New Mexico, USA. It seems they all died together. Maybe they were traveling and feeding in a group that was swept away by a sudden flood and drowned together in a big heap. So they will admit that this localized, sometimes, flooding may have taken place, but as far as a worldwide flood's concerned, forget it. Okay, now have a look at this one. This is in the British National History Museum, and a fossil displayed in the British Museum of Natural History. The description reads, "Mammal graveyard. The fossilized remains of an antelope, gazelle, horse, and carnivore are preserved in this slab. The fossils are surrounded by floodplain deposits, suggesting that the animals were swept together by torrential floods. There is no weather in the little damage to the fossils, so they must have been buried quickly." So even the British Museum has this caption, so why is it so imperative that they ignore the possibility of a universal flood? The reason is, of course, if that took place, they don't believe in an ark or anything like that. That means everything was wiped out at once and everything would have had to have started right from the beginning, and that's impossible because there just isn't enough time for that to have taken place. Right, what does the Bible say? Genesis 7, 19 to 20. "The water prevailed more and more upon the earth, so that all the high mountains everywhere under the heavens were covered." So the whole world was underwater. "The water prevailed 15 cubits higher, and mountains covered." So it confirms it twice there, that everything was underwater at the same time. And I mentioned earlier something called the Cretaceous layer. Now the Cretaceous layer is the one layer that is universal. It's the only layer that is universal. And in some areas it's deep, in other areas it's less deep, but it covers the whole world and it's universal. And it's a chalk layer that covers the whole world and it's packed full of marine deposits. And if that is a fact, and it is, that can only mean one thing, that the whole world was underwater at the same time. Scientific evidence that the Bible was right after all. Okay, now we get to the whole topic of the birds. Did dinosaurs evolve into birds, as is being taught in our schools every single day? But that's a topic in itself, so we're going to leave that till after the interval. We'll also be talking then about, is there any possibility man and dinosaurs could have coexisted? And we'll be looking at ancient, millions and millions and millions of year old fossils, and we'll be looking at the modern living form to see how much evolution has taken place between them. Okay, so stick around, it's going to be pretty exciting in the second half. Thank you for listening so far. All right, welcome back everyone. So, part two, did dinosaurs give rise to birds? Is there evidence that dinosaurs and people lived at the same time? What do the earliest fossils tell us? That's what we'll be looking at as well. And then we'll be drawing our final conclusions from that. Okay. So, did dinosaurs evolve into birds? Science says yes. And if you look at the textbooks in museums, you will find pictures like this, the Velociraptor and the Oviraptor, and they had feathers, and they're depicted as taking care of their little eggs. And there was this great transition from dinosaurs through to modern birds. Now then, Archaeopteryx, a very famous fossil. It's now generally accepted that Archaeopteryx was a bird with fully formed flying feathers and a wishbone. Now then, this was decided at a meeting which was held in 1982, and this is a quote from a book called Science versus Evolution by Vince Farrell. And it says here, it's significant that a special scientific meeting was held in 1982, the International Archaeopteryx Conference held in Ickstadt, Germany. At this meeting, it was decided by the evolutionists that the Archaeopteryx is a bird, and not a reptile or half-bird, half-reptile. It was also decided that Archaeopteryx was not necessarily the ancestor of modern birds. But, if you go to the museums, this is one I went to in Torquay called Dinosaur World, by the way. It's right down on the seafront. It looks just like a shop front from the beginning, but when you go in there, it's quite vast as you go in. And there's this fossil here, which is, I assume is an impression, it didn't really say. And I read I took this photo myself, read what it said on the board, and it said, do you find it hard to believe that birds came from dinosaurs? Archaeopteryxes, they could easy. They were a bit of both. They were covered in feathers. They also had a mouthful of little teeth and bones in their tails, which birds don't have anymore. Right, now, this one here, the Conifusiosaurus, very long name there, that was a bird, undisputed bird, that lived at the time, that also had bony, long bony tail as well. So that maybe that's that little theory out of the window. On we go. The Hoatzin, they have tiny claws on their hands, just like the Archaeopteryx did. So that's also a modern feature as well. On we go. And these are greylag geese, and you can see very clearly these are living today. They have teeth in their beaks, all right? And then this is a fossilized bird called the Hesperornis regalis, and this too had tiny little teeth. This lived at the time. And this was an undisputed, fully formed bird as well. Right, now then, I'm going to give you some brand new stuff now, okay? So this stuff only came out in November and December last year, which they say also proves that there was this transition from dinosaurs to birds. This is the first one. This is in the I newspaper, and it was on the BBC website and all over the place as well. 11th of November 2016, Chinese dragon shows how birds rose from dinosaurs. Basically, they found this fossil, obviously in China, and it's of a dinosaur, but transitioning into a bird, that's what they're saying, buried in mud, interesting. And also, well, I'll show you the fossil in a minute, the head is thrown back as well. And I'll show you what that means a little bit. But they said it was struggling to get out the mud, that was the whole problem. And they say that there's evidence that it had feathers, and that the limbs here, though, weren't long enough to be wings, so that shows that they were transitioning from the one to the other, so it couldn't actually fly, because it's mid-evolution, that's what they were saying. And it also had a beak as well. So there's all this evidence to suggest, people read that, of course, and think, well, that sounds good, so, you know, obviously, dinosaurs did evolve into birds, all this evidence we have. Now then, firstly, this comes from the Institute of Creation research. Often these articles come out in the newspaper, and then about a week later, the creation scientists have had a good chance to look at it, and then they'll bring out an article saying what they think. The evidence for feathers is only quill knobs, which are little bumps on the bones. Moreover, no feathers can be seen in this fossil. I'll show you the fossil a little bit, and you can decide for yourself. Brian Thomas, the ICR science writer, explains. In 2007, scientists claimed to have identified quill knobs in a velociraptor fossil. Since then, secular researchers have interpreted quill knobs for other similar dinosaurs. But what if the first identification of velociraptor quill knobs was wrong? Last, these tiny bone bumps have more uses than just anchoring feathers. They sometimes mark attachment points for connective tissue, so they could have been used for something else. The fact that the limbs weren't long enough to be wings could mean that they maybe weren't wings but legs, possibly as well. So there's that. The head going back in the fossil, by the way, very often, if creatures are buried quickly, it's a last gasp attempt to try and bring in a bit of air. So they throw their head back, take a last gasp, and then are buried. So that would explain why that happened. And the mud, of course, could possibly have been something to do with the flood. Now, I read all of that, and I thought, hang on, what about the beak? They haven't explained anything about the beak. So does this mean that they have no answer to that, the creationists? Well, I emailed the Institute for Creation Research and asked them this very question, and they emailed back within a day, which was good, so 29th of November 2016 via email. Andrew, thank you, and that's a great question. Oh. These dinosaurs did not really have a beak like modern birds. Oviraptors had toothless jaws that were made completely of bone. You can see it just there. Unlike bird beaks, to call it a beak is really a misnomer, as they say. And I can't see any feathers here, so we've already seen that they are only these quill knobs, and they might have been used for attaching connective tissue anyway. So that's not necessarily the case. And this is very much the size of a dinosaur as well. So probability, in my opinion, it's a dinosaur. Right, moving on. This is even more recent. This was in December. And I think it first came out December the 8th. Now then, this is a piece of amber that they found. And they say that this is a part of a dinosaur tail, fossilized in amber. And if we see a close-up, you can see fully formed feathers there as well. And this is how the artist depicts the dinosaur. And it's got these feathers growing all over it, and this is part of the tail. Now, first point about this is that feathers in dinosaurs are usually depicted as just being kind of fuzz, not fully formed feathers like this. I'll show you what I mean in a minute. And this has been established for some time, it's fuzz. If you see all these fossils in China that they show, it's basically feather fuzz, not fully formed feathers like this. Secondly, we've already seen that other extinct birds had bony tails as well, all right, that were fully formed birds, but because they're saying birds don't have these tails anymore, so it must be a dinosaur because it had a bony tail. But there were at least two species that did. And then Dr. David Menton from the Answers in Genesis website, that's a really good website to get onto if you want to check out the creationist viewpoint. We conclude that DIP V15103, they haven't named it yet, is a bird, and not a 99-million-year-old theropod dinosaur. This is supported by the discovery of 99-million-year-old bird wings, including bones and feathers, found by Lydia Zing et al., in the same type of Burmese amber as DIP V15103. I reject the age assigned to these fossils, but it shows that small birds, perhaps juveniles, left evidence of the unquestionably bird-like anatomy in Burmese amber. So where's the evolution? So reading between the lines here, he's either saying that this could actually be part of a wing, a bird wing, and not a tail, or he's basically saying that there could have been a feathered bird tail and wings in the same kind of fossil at the same time. So it's no real evidence of evolution. Good point. Okay, now this is what they normally show us. So this is Sinoceropteryx. This is a dinosaur, but these are meant to be feather impressions here, although they're not actually clear as feathers at all. So let's see what the top scientists now have to say about this. So these are not creationists now, these are evolutionary scientists, and let's see what they have to say about this. Okay, this is from the Cincinnati Inquirer, 1997. New research shows that birds lack the embryonic thumb that dinosaurs had. suggesting that it's almost impossible for the species to be closely related, so the embryos are different. A team led by bird expert Anna Feducia, chairman of biology at Northern University of Carolina, studied bird embryos under a microscope and published this study in the journal Science. So highly qualified people, we'll see what they concluded a little bit later. Fellow expert Alan Brush, University of Connecticut Stores, points out that they lack the organisation found in modern feathers. So is he saying that they are not feathers at all, maybe? And a team led by John Rubin, a respiratory physiology expert at Oregon State University, and ancient bird expert Larry Martin, believe that the so-called feather traces are actually frayed collagen fibres beneath the skin. Yeah, so basically we have a series of fibres on top of our bones, the kit helps us to keep our shape. It's below the skin. It's fibrous, your fibres going in all directions. So if something was buried and fossilised, then there's a good chance that you'd be able to see that as well. And that's a pretty good explanation. The other thing is that I've seen fossils, the one I saw was a fish that had collagen fibres that looked just like that. And obviously fish have got nothing to do with dinosaurs and nothing to do with birds. So we can find them in other fossils as well. Rubin also analysed the fostral outlines of Sinostrosaurus' internal organs, and he says its bellow-like lungs could not have evolved into the high-performance lungs of modern birds. So it's not just about feathers. Let's look at the lungs for a minute as well. It's not just about feathers. There's all kinds of physiological problems as well. And just before I mention that, there is the fact that birds have got hollow bones, all right, which aids flight. Dinosaurs have solid bones, so that would have all had to have changed as well. But basically, mammals and people have lungs like this. So we breathe in, and our lung fills up like a balloon. There's this mixing of the air with the air that's already inside. We breathe out, and when we breathe out, then there's less oxygen in the atmosphere than there was before. So if we go climbing, for example, and we go very, 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 very high, the oxygen levels are less, and we start to struggle. So we have to try and breathe faster, and we're struggling to breathe. So if people go to the top of Mount Everest, for example, they have to take with them an oxygen bottle. And when they're at the top of Mount Everest, with their oxygen bottle admiring the view, guess what goes past? Quack, 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 quack. A bunch of geese. And they might be thinking, well, what have they got that I haven't got? How come they could be up there and I can't be up there? Well, you see, birds have completely different lungs. They don't have this mixing process that goes on. They have a bunch of sacs before the lungs, and a bunch of sacs after the lungs, and the air passes straight through them in little tubes. So there's no similarity between a mammalian lung or a human lung and a bird lung. So you couldn't get the one evolving out of the other. And besides which, feathers are such complex organisms in themselves that they could never develop incrementally to be effective. They would have to be there, fully formed, will be absolutely useless. It's another case of irreducible complexity. All right, Barbara J. Stahl, what did she say? She's from St. Elms College in the USA, and she said, it seems from the complex construction of feathers that their evolution from reptilian scales would have required an immense period of time and involved a series of intermediate structures. So far, the fossil record does not bear out that supposition. And Professor Walter Veith in Bones and Stones 2004, I'll give you the link for that at the end, it's also on the fact sheets over there if you'd like to take one. Feathers could never develop to be incrementally effective. As I've already said, they would have to be there, fully formed, or be completely useless. Right, Storrs Olsen. He's curator of birds at the National Museum of Natural History of the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C., so highly, highly qualified, wrote in response to a National Geographic article that just plastered it all over the world that it's a fact, birds came from dinosaurs. Listen to what this expert has to say to them. The feathered dinosaur pictures are simply imaginary and have no place outside of science fiction. Do they ever tell our children that in the schools? No. All you get is one-sided propaganda. In fact, that is bad science because it's based on a lie. The idea of feathered dinosaurs and the therapeutic origin of birds has been actively propagated by a cadre of zealous scientists acting in concert with certain editors at Nature and National Geographic, who themselves have become outspoken and highly biased proselytes of the faith. Truth and careful scientific weighing of the evidence have been among the first casualties in their program, which is now fast becoming one of the grandest scientific hoaxes of our age. The paleontological equivalent of cold fusion. There's no such thing, and yet our children are being subjected to it every single day. Alan Fiducia and his team, what did they conclude? It is biophysically impossible to evolve flight from such large bipeds with foreshortened forelimbs and heavy balancing tails. Exactly the wrong anatomy for flight. The theropod dinosaur origin of birds, in my opinion, will be the greatest embarrassment of the paleontology of the 20th century. Will science heed it? I doubt it. They will preach it and teach it because that's the only solution that they have. Because where did the birds come from, if they didn't come from something? Because God's not going to be acknowledged ever. Creation's not going to be acknowledged ever. They seem to think complexity could just fall from the sky. Okay, moving on to the next topic. Did people and dinosaurs live at the same time? Science, of course, says no way. There was millions and millions of years between. Okay, let's have a look at some evidence. Right, now these are the Ica stones from ancient Indian cultures. Now then, I saw a program on TV about this. It was on one of the Sky channels, something like the Discovery Channel, that kind of thing. And it was called Weird or What. You might have seen it now and again. William Shatner presents it. And Series 2, Episode 10, they featured the Ica stones on there. Now, if we look at them, there's a Triceratops, if ever I saw one. There's another Triceratops. There's some theropods there. You've got a pterodactyl there with a person flying on them. That's all very interesting. And there's all these kind of interesting ones here. And there are thousands and thousands and thousands of them. And they put forward different viewpoints on this on the program. So one person was on there to see if she could forge them. So could they prove that they were forgeries? And yeah, she showed how you could do this and you could do that and you could put this on it to make it look old and et cetera, et cetera. So she was arguing, oh, they know they're forgeries. Then you had your evolutionist saying, oh, no, they're definitely fakes, found to be fakes, no question whatsoever. Then they got a guy to analyze them and found, no, they are actually very, 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 very old. So they're not forgeries, they do actually date back, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of years to these times. So people then, could we conclude, had knowledge of dinosaurs way before science says that they did. So they were trying to take a balanced viewpoint at the end and said, okay, so obviously people didn't live with dinosaurs, because we know that from science. So what we'll say is that those people, they must have had knowledge from somewhere. They must have, somebody must have given it to them, that's all we can say. They must have had this knowledge. One of the interesting things is that all the anatomy and everything was all very accurate as well. Even the dinosaurs had the right number of toes on the feet as well, which is pretty good for people who have never actually seen dinosaurs. And this one guy put forward a theory that people from Atlantis, the Atlantic, the city buried below, they might have gone around the world and told everybody about dinosaurs, and that's how they knew about it. So they were trying to kind of get the balance there. Or the other alternative is that people and dinosaurs did live together, of course. Right, dinosaur cave drawings. So there we have the Grand Canyon. There's some kind of theropod there. In America, there's a sauropod. Another one over there. You've got another sauropod there, and yet another sauropod over there as well. So how did these people have the knowledge if they'd never seen dinosaurs? Now this is a 12th century Cambodian temple at Angkor Wat. And this is one of the pillars here. There it is. And this one here, if we look at it, any guesses as to what that looks like? Stegosaurus, yeah. And there's a Stegosaurus just there, of course, another one. And those do look very much like the kind of plates that it would have had on its back. I've seen many explanations as to what it could be instead, but none of them were really very convincing. One person said that perhaps these plates aren't actually part of the animal, perhaps the animal is just this. So we forget about the plates and just look at that instead and try and work out what that might be instead. But not the most convincing argument in the world. So there's something else for you to think about. And then this, original photograph of Civil War soldiers with a dead pterodactyl. Right, now that is interesting. And I did quite a bit of research on this. And this is actually, it's not photoshopped, It's actually the original photograph. Some people have produced Photoshop versions of it with something else there instead, but they said, no, those are the forgeries. This is actually the original. And one of the stories according to this was it was taken near Vicksburg, Mississippi in 1864. And yeah, quite remarkable. Okay, now this one as well. A wooden headdress by the Olivetorn people of Cameroon in West Africa in the early 1800s. That looks a heck of a lot like a theropod dinosaur just there. And Pterodactylus here. This is a variation on the pterodactyl, of course, and that looks very, very similar as well. Okay, now if you go to the Bible, people will tell you that the Bible doesn't mention dinosaurs at all. But the word dinosaur wasn't even invented until 1841 by Sir Richard Owen, who called them Dinosauria, which was terrible lizard. And if we look in the Bible, 24 times, dragons, serpents, Leviathan is another one as well, as mentioned over there, are also mentioned in the Bible all over the place. And what's a dragon? It's a terrible lizard. Alright, so the word means the same thing. So maybe the Bible does refer to it. Let's have a look at one particular example in the book of Job, chapter 40, verses 15-24. I'm not going to read all of it, but just the bits that I've underlined. What strength it has in its loins, what power in the muscles of its belly, its tail sways like a cedar, huge cedar tree. Its bones are tubes of bronze, its limbs are like rods of iron, it is secure, though the Jordan surge against its mouth. So we said that those kind of sauropods might have been river feeding animals, and even with the water gushing against it, it's unshakable. People have come along and said, no, it's probably an elephant that they're referring to there. Does an elephant have a tail like a cedar tree? Huge swaying tail? No. The other thing put forward was that it's a hippopotamus. And again, you've got a tiny little tail there. Doesn't sway like a huge cedar tree, but a sauropod does. So maybe they are referring to that. There are many sightings, particularly, as I said earlier, in the Congo, of what can be described as a sauropod. Right, now then, Stan Taylor. Now this is called the Taylor Trail, the Pawlaxe River in Glen Rose in Texas, called the Taylor Trail. And there's your fossil there, and you can see then the outline there. So he began his excavation of the Taylor Trail in 1969, continued working until 1972, and he found certain footprints of dinosaur footprints going on. But then, in 1999, there was a drought, and all of a sudden, you could see the entire trail going on there as well. And there's one where the human footprint and the dino footprint actually cross over each other at the same time. Some people say that these things are faked. Okay, now here's a slab of northern Texas limestone found in July 2000. And we can see there's your dino footprint, and there's your human footprint straight over the top of it. Now if you look at this point here, you can see that the human footprint was probably made first because the mud is pushed forward by the dino impression there, as you can see. Right, so they looked at this. This was found by Alvis Delk. It was the person who actually found it. And they looked at this and they did a kind of CT scan of it all the way through to try and check out what was going on. And they figured out that if it wasn't faked, then you obviously have evidence of the mud being depressed. Whereas if it's a carving, it would just be carved into the mud and the mud at the bottom would remain as it was. And if you can see these shadowed areas here, they actually show where the mud was indeed compressed down. So these are not fakes, this is a genuine fossil. Okay, more food for thought. Where do all the legends and myths about dragons come from? Ancient writers, such as poets and historians, are not even talking about science, mentioning these creatures, such as dragons, living in Africa and even the jungles elsewhere. Science books of the 1300s seem to describe dinosaurs. There are many records and sightings of creatures that can only be described as dinosaurs. Marco Polo, in his travels in the late 1200s, for example, came back and he said he saw dinosaurs, dragons as he called them then, because the word dinosaur didn't exist, in China, and some were actually pulling chariots as well. There are many other sightings all over the place. If you Google living dinosaurs on Google, they come all over the place. So are the lizards of today much different, or are they just smaller? This is a basilisk, and pretty cute, I think. Nice little cute, it looks just like something out of science fiction. But imagine if a paleontologist got hold of this fossil, and it didn't live today, what would he do with it? It would be the vicious thing, the most vicious thing that lived. In actual fact, it's an omnivore, surviving on a diet of plant material, insects, food, and small vertebrates. So not necessarily vicious carnivores at all. Science will tell us about what's happening in the world today, all right? And they'll say mass extinctions are going on. Scientists agree the world faces mass extinction. Only 10% of the big sea fish remain. We're in the midst of a sixth mass extinction. So we're getting less and less and less. So natural selection is doing a really good job of getting rid of everything on the planet, and scientists are screaming and saying, if we don't stop this, there'll be nothing left. So have we got low diversity to high diversity, or have we had high diversity in the past and we're marching towards low diversity? Exactly the opposite, which is what we were alluding to earlier. Okay, now this is an ammonite, and it doesn't live anymore, but there's the fossil of it there, and it's basically like an octopus that would swim through the sea, propelling itself along. And it's a highly complex squid-like creature, lived in a swell, lived in a shell, rather, and swam in the sea just like modern squids do without their shells. And if we look at the fossil there it is, and it's very similar to others that we might see today. Right, now look at this, the trilobite. There's the fossil, there's the version that they said, there's the fossil. These are the trilobites that science depicts as ancient and the first organisms to evolve, which is rubbish, of course, because we saw everything was there at the same time. They're highly complex and they do not live today, but there's nothing simple about them. So if we look at that previous one, highly complex. Look at this one, highly complex as well. So where's the simplicity to complexity that we should be seeing? That's the question with those. Nautilus, there's the fossilized version, meant to be millions of years old. There's the modern version that's still living today. No change at all, identical, no evolution. And this is what they're like on the inside. And this is a highly simplified diagram, by the way. Highly, highly complex, nothing simple about them whatsoever. They had all the structures, all the organs that they needed. Very, very complex design. Sea stars, there they are in the fossil record, there they are today, no change. Horseshoe crabs, in the fossil record, there they are today, no change. That's meant to be 450 million years old. So where is this story then of simple to complex? It doesn't exist. When they appear, they're like this, and today, they're like this. Okay, the coelacanth. Now, coelacanths are thought to be extinct for 6 million years, and then they found one, this is in the 1930s, found by Smith, and they looked at it, and they looked at the fossil, and there's no change whatsoever. And they were depicted as being creatures that were showing an evolution to land animals, because they claimed that these long fins they had here would have enabled them to be able to walk on land as well. And when they actually observed the coelacanth, it doesn't walk on land at all. It only uses those for swimming. So many other fish today could come out and walk. Some can even hop as well, but they don't go onto the land. They might just go onto the rocks for a short time and then go back into the water. And they've always been like that as well. I saw a picture recently, which was mocking creation, saying that they'd found these fish that were developing arms and legs. But if we look back in the fossil record, they've been like that all the way down. Right, so a fossil jellyfish discovered in Utah. So there's the fossil version, there's the modern one. Again, fossil version, modern one, very, very similar. The researchers, 2007, likened the two fossils pictured here to living species from the genus Canina and Periphylla, that's the bottom one. If verified, these connections would suggest that jellies evolved into their current complex form very quickly, around 500 million years ago, which backs up what we were saying earlier. Maybe they appeared fully formed in the first place. Sharks of the past. Okay, now look at that. There's a fully grown great white shark. There's the one from the past. It's absolutely enormous. Nothing exists like it today. These are toys, the ones we have today, in comparison to what used to exist in the past. Everything was way, way bigger. We haven't got evolution, we've got devolution. We've gone downhill. And then iguanas. Give them 1,000 years, how big could they grow? Well, you'd probably fill the room with them. And that would be scary, or would it? What do they actually eat? What do iguanas eat? Anybody know?
Seaweed.
That's what they eat. No one would ever guess if a paleontologist found that, but that's what they eat. Not highly vicious at all. Crocodiles. Crocodiles that live today, again, are dinky toys in comparison to what we have today. I'll show you the difference. There we are. So there's the one from the past. There's the one, the fully grown one, that lives today. So no difference in the anatomy. So there's no evolution there. The only difference is the size. And we've already said earlier, why were they so big? Well, probably conditions were different in the past. There was less disease, the environment was better, more food was more plentiful, and they had much, much more time to grow. Okay, now then, the eye of an insect. Now, the human eye is already a nightmare for evolutionists, but this one is even more of a nightmare because it's made up of these hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tiny little mirrors. There they are, and each one is absolutely perfect. It's another example of irreducible complexity, because if just one of those mirrors is off, then the whole thing wouldn't work. So it had to be there, fully formed at the same time. NASA actually used this as a design for their reflecting telescopes that they use in space. It's absolutely perfect. Now, if we go back into the fossil record and see one fossilized in amber, we would expect, it's hundreds of millions of years ago, that they would be further on down the evolution scale. But there it is, fossilized in amber, there's the eye. Exactly as it is today, absolutely perfect, no change at all. An ant in amber, no change to the modern one at all. No wonder this ant is saying to this one, I can't believe it, Fred. 60 million years since I've seen you and you haven't changed a bit. Right, George Gaylord Simpson, one of the great doyens of evolution, he said, it's been suggested that animals are now specialised and that the generalised forms on which all major evolutionary developments depend are absent. In fact, all animals have always been more or less specialised, and a really generalised living form is merely a myth or an abstraction. So what's that in simple language? He's saying there's no such thing as an animal that developed from simple to complex. It's a myth. Okay, so is it true, what science is telling us, that we've gone from simple to complex? No, everything's always been complex right from the start. Is it true we went from low diversity to high diversity? No, we've gone from high diversity to low diversity. Is it true that animals appeared gradually over time? No, they appeared suddenly in the fossil record, exactly as they are today. Now you think about these things, all right, because I'm not making any of this up. We're looking at the top scientists in the world here. These are the people that know what they're talking about. But then you've got these pop media scientists as well, still pushing Darwinian evolution in the faces of our children, preaching it as if it's fact. Okay, now then, even some evolutionists have had to change to punctuated equilibriumists because the fossil record's not telling them what it's meant to be telling them. It won't do it, it can't do it, as we've seen from the scientists themselves. If everything was there from the beginning, there's no difference between that and creation, except you left out what? God. That's the only thing they've left out. They're calling it sudden burst of evolutionary creativity, and they've just left out God. So is there a God or isn't there a God? You decide. Okay, these are the Valvitias. These are plants that grow and grow and grow. And you find them in the deserts, in Namibia, for example. And they can tell us certain things about how long things have been around. And these are bristlecone pines, the oldest trees in the world. How old are the oldest ones in the world? 4,000 to 5,000 years. A few years ago, they said, oh, 6,000. But then they realised they weren't dealing with the tree ring dating system properly. So now most people agree 4,000 to 5,000 years. There is some school of thought that says 8,000, but then you have to start comparing dead trees with the living ones and start to try and do cross dating, and then a whole load of assumptions come into it. And we saw last time the problems that assumptions can cause because it can affect accuracy massively. If we go to places like the Redwoods National State Park, giant trees here, massive, huge ones. Now these trees are amazing because this one here has been damaged by fire, but the bark is fireproof. So even if a huge fire spreads throughout the entire park, these trees will survive. So these are first generation forests. Nothing was there before. How old are the oldest ones in the world? 4,000 to 5,000 years old. First generation rivers. They can tell how long the rivers have been there as well. They do that by placing nets into rivers, because they're looking to build dams usually, and to work out how economically feasible the dam will be, because otherwise the dam will fill up in a certain amount of time. They put the nets in and they work out how much silt is coming down over a period of time. Then they take a satellite photograph and they can see how much silt has been brought down in the river's entire lifetime. And the oldest rivers in the world, 4,000 to 5,000 years old. And some people would say to me, yeah, but hang on, we've got archaeological evidence from China, from all these places, that everything's been around much longer than that. Egyptology, for example, at one stage they were saying that Egypt had been around for like 8,000 to 10,000 years. But what have happened to the dates in China? What have happened to the dates in Egypt? What have happened to the dates in Mesopotamia? They've got shorter and shorter and shorter. And now if somebody even dares mention 3000 BC, which is only 5,000 years ago, they'll put a plus minus after it, because they know that in a few weeks or a few months' time, more evidence will come and the dates will change again. Why? Because in the past, they used to put all the kings sequential. So they thought, this king ruled for this length of time, this king ruled for that length of time, this king ruled for this length of time, and had this huge line of kings going all the way back 8,000 to 10,000 years. And then they found out, oops, it was father and son ruling at the same time. Or father and three sons ruling at the same time. So the dates went, bang. And now we're down to a very interesting scenario, which is 4,000 to 5,000 years ago. So, this is the bottom line. Everything appeared at the same time, everything was fully formed, no change from one form to another, and scientists seem to be dealing with one basic problem, a denial of divinity. It's got nothing to do with science, and you can believe whoever you want. That choice is yours, but you shouldn't have to be exposed to lies in order to make a theory fit. Okay, thank you for listening. If you want to check out some more, Professor Walter J. Brief on YouTube, Bones in Stones, Dr. G. Charles Jackson, The Death of Darwinism, highly recommend that one as well. There's fact sheets there for you to have a look at as well. But thank you so much for listening. There'll be future seminars as well on other subjects to do with this, depending on where you are. And I look forward to you joining me again, and we'll have a look at some more.